I'll introduce. I can be found on LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, and so on. I work for the Donation Trust Bank, as well as I do a few other jobs as well. I'm a director of Lanka Financial Bureau. We provide security infrastructure in Sri Lanka. And also I'm sitting on the Governing Council of NIBM. I started as an engineer. I'm not a banker. It's the 6 years that I became a banker. I also have an MBA from BIM. I also have been to London Business School and NCR in France for my management development program. Actually, I have 30 years experience. I found one few years ago, so it's not 29 years ago. But it doesn't mean much, by the way. Everything one has learned over the last 30 years doesn't mean much. What matters is last few years. So I started my career with John Keels and I moved to Stanford Bank. My experience covers strategy, technology, digital transformation, banking operation, operational risk, client service, and I have been working in a number of places in the world before I came back to Sri Lanka a few years ago. I also have been on various public forums, in press and things like that. Been on national TV, the radio and stuff. Okay, that's basically we talked about me, but other than work, I do other things. Also, I do running. I play golf. I do sailing. I do riding. I do diving as well. And I do photography. So, other than digital, there's a lot of work other to do, so it's good to have work-life balance. Okay, now we'll talk about serious stuff. So, a lot of technologies have come and gone, but I think digital is going to stay. I think your generation is born to that, so you think it's normal. But when I was born, we didn't have telephone at home. So I remember when I went to the boarding school in 1975. So my father applied for a SLT telephone connection. So it came to, they installed it in 1988. By then I had left the school and gone to the university and started working also. But really, like, you can just go to across the road, dialogue, you can get a SIM, you know, you're up and running. So, with this whole normalcy we have established, so digital is going to stay. So our mission is nothing but to provide a frictionless experience for our customers, right? So how we do, and because this is a buzzword everyone's talking about, but I think it's a very good practice. So we also have physical channels, which is obviously, right? The banks are very boring, right? Isn't it? They are, because every process is driven, right? But I don't think your generation will easily survive. But having said that, I have about 55% of my staff are your generation, right? So we have done something probably right for them to come and work for us. So it's important for to have digital as well as physical channels, modern as well as appealing. But the second part is probably what I was trying to say. See, when you implement technology, how many of them are working? Working or still struggling? Lucky. Okay. So when you go to work, you will find a lot of organizations talk about customers. I mean, it's the right thing to do because they pay our salaries, right? But when you implement the system, you end up doing a beautiful website, beautiful app and things like that. But you go to the back end, where really things happen, it's manual. You know, in banking, you have this famous term, straight-through processing. So you input something on a mobile app, say you want to do a fund transfer from one bank to another. You input something, it just happens, right? It's straight through processing, there's no human intervention on the back end. But some actually the STP goes to straight to people, straight to printers. So what happens is your instruction gets printed by someone, go and input another system, then you do it. So this is the boring part of banking, okay? But if you do real STP, straight through processing versus straight to people or straight to printers, people get bored and they don't want to work for banking. So it's important when we do systems or mobile or whatever technology you want to implement, you have to look at not only for the customers, the users of the system as well. So that's very, very important. So that's why I say it has to be empowering technology for people to have to feel that, you know, if it all happens, I have nothing much to do about it, and it's secure, it's all mistakes are built into the system. So probably you may have heard this kind of design thinking, have you? Have you read about it? So design thinking is nothing but to start everything from the customer's point of view. The customer is normally the ultimate customer, you know, the users. So their experience matters. We are not into bankers are not supposed to do that. Because if you look at the cost of bribery and corruption across the globe, any guesses? I don't know you all read, right? There's $1.3 trillion per annum. Politicians and government officials, they rob that amount of money. So we have a responsibility to not do that. Same if I have heard a saying. So we have stopped AML, anti-money laundering, or the risk management, things like that. So then, you know, this whole document will be stopped. They have to do judgment calls. Yeah? So that's how you design systems. Then also, if you go back to 10 years ago, 20 years ago, we love to compete with someone. Okay? Like, you know, HMB is my computer, so I don't want to talk to you, kind of thing. And, you know, that's how it was. It was because of the old business model where, you know, we had. But now the world has changed. We are in a connected world. So if you're smart, what you should do, you must connect. Now, I don't mind. Now, Dialogue is talking about some financial services, for example. Similarly, Mobile is talking about that. For that matter, everyone wants to do financial services. Everything, it's cool and it's easy to do. So in my case, I don't mind connecting with them, you know, work together. So that's collaboration. So that's one thing we want to do. In fact, I'll talk about something we have done. So you have connected a number of banks through one of our apps. You can do transaction without even having money in our bank. Right? We'll talk about it in a minute. So innovation could be a major role in understanding new disruptive technology and solutions. So when we talk about innovation, obviously everything is technology. Actually it's not. So have you heard about the story, I don't know if it's a joke or true story, when the Americans were trying to go to the moon, way back in 1969, you know, it's zero gravity, right? That you know, right? So they gave you a ballpoint pen to write. When it is zero gravity, it can't write. You know, there's no gravitational force pulling the ink down. So America can spend about large amount of money when trying to develop this zero gravity pen. But whereas Russians took a pencil and went and wrote within the pen. So innovation does not have to be technology. So don't get sort of stuck with technology alone. There are other ways of innovating. So from a bank point of view, we do think of risk management, right? Actually, everyone does risk management. And you don't go to a high-rise building and put a meter and say it's safe, right? And you always take precautions and you will not cross the road when there's a vehicle coming straight after you, right? So that is risk management. Similarly, in the bank, we do lots of things because we are the custodian of public funds. All of you give us money, right? And we safeguard and we take money, we pay you interest, and then we take that money, give it to someone else, we lend. And we make a little bit more money, that's our bank net profit. But we have a large responsibility, apart from the AML and things like that, to safeguard the banking system. So you need to do a lot of risk management. That's a very special area. I'm not going to talk about it, but the point is, now, when it comes to digital world, your risk management becomes different. For an example, we didn't have information security issues 10, 15 years ago. But now everybody will hear that someone has hacked someone's website, someone has stolen money, someone has bullied someone, say, okay, pay me 10,000 bitcoins, otherwise I'm not going to release your system kind of thing. So risk management has become a different thing now. So we are on mobile, we are on cloud now. We all know about it and a lot of people are using it. So anything what you're going to do from technology side, you have to be aware of this, not that you have to stick with it, but this is what is going to happen. So when you go cloud, when you go mobile, it's easy to implement your system, it's faster, you can do faster implementation as well. Then the biggest one, sorry about that, we all have heard this big data, analytics, BI, MI, and all that. So that is going to be a very, very important piece in businesses now. So you've got to be aware of that as well. Okay, coming to your topic, I was brief that, you know, you have some assignment, talk about websites and things like that. So I'd like to draw your attention to this slide. So this is a web web traffic in January 2018. I'm pretty current. So if you look at 23% of web traffic is going from the desktop, 36 mobile, and 2% is tablet, and there are other things insignificant. But if you look at year-on-year change, the web traffic has gone down on desktops as well as tablets. So what is actually growing is the mobile. So it is safe to say whatever we do with technology is good to focus on mobiles, because that is what people are using, and we all, right? So desktops and tablets are, I'm saying, dying, but it's becoming a bit irrelevant. So we'll pay a lot of attention to this. So if you're going to use technology and whatever the assignment you're talking about, this is one thing that you should be worried about. Then if you look at Sri Lanka, we have almost 21 million population. And we have very interesting stat. Not sure if you knew this. We have 131% phone density. So what does it mean? Everyone has more than one phone on average, which is very interesting. Okay. So if you put these two together, if you are going to deploy technology for whatever the business you are going to engage in your professional career later, this is going to be actually one important area. So a lot of people got mobile, so any service, any product you can deliver via mobile is going to be quite successful. Bit of global stats. Why is it so important, the digital economy, why is it so important? If you look at stats, the World Bank estimates the digital economy globally to be around $11.5 trillion. That's a huge amount of money. If you look at the same in Sri Lanka, the McKinsey did a study last year, sorry, I think early this year, they believe if by 2019, the GDP of Sri Lanka can grow by 1-3%. That is about $3 billion. I mean, for a country like ours, our economy is about $90 billion. This could be quite significant, right? And you can build maybe 100 hospitals with this money. So digital economy has a significant importance for a country like Sri Lanka. Few things to note to enable a digital ecosystem. Sorry, before I go to this, are you all sort of tech savvy people? I mean, do you have subject on technology and tech savvy? Not really. Okay. It's okay. So to enable a digital ecosystem, but I think as business, I think you're a business group, right?
Yeah.
So you should know this. You will work with technology colleagues when you go to work. They will start talking about this jargon like APIs, payment, blockchain, and things like that. So it's important for you to know this, otherwise you can get lost, right? And someone will, you know, take you for a ride if you find the wrong person. So you should know that. So there are few things you should know for sure: the APIs, the blockchain, and regulatory standard system. Because when it comes to payments, you need regulation because you're, as I said, I spoke about AML and things like a few minutes ago. At the same time, you have to ensure, you know, the money that I sent from my account to your account is gone. You know, there has to be some kind of regulation. So Central Bank of Sri Lanka does that regulation in our case, right? And the open APIs, API stands for Application Program Interface, which basically can connect multiple people in the ecosystem. So basically, these few things are the enablers of a digital payment system or ecosystem. Are you familiar with this? What's happening in the world? The world is actually changing. We said we are going to mobile. I think we have already gone to social, like a lot of things happening in the social space. And then a lot of analytics taking place, because when you collect a lot of data, all these things, everything becomes an interaction point, right? Now, by now, Apple knows that I came here. And Apple knows that, you know, I got caught in traffic jam and I was coming. Or even everyone knows that. Right? So all these things can be used for business, good business purpose. So analytics you should know, cloud you should know. Cloud is more like a computer and resources. It's in a cloud. It's not in your data center. It's not in your office. Have you heard about Airbnb? Is it a success story? No? been a tremendous success story. But this all happened because of the things that I spoke earlier. So they managed to put things on a mobile or digital platform. They managed to connect the whole world like instantaneously. And managed to actually unlock a lot of hidden resources, like a room in someone's house was never making money, but now it can make money. So you know, they created a new economy. I mean, even things like Pikmi, Sri Lanka, and a lot of things, it created different brand new economies in the existing world. And if you read books, so this is another interesting example, Kindle. Now, if you want to publish a book, what do? I mean, you, I mean, if you're interested in books, I read, but I'm not good at writing. But if you want to publish a book, you do your draft, look for a publishing house, you go and meet the editor, you know, the big boss, right? So he will say, no, I don't think this is a good book, you know, just go away. You know, only very few people can still have the opportunity to publish books, right? That's because, you know, it happens that way. So this editor was a more like gatekeeper. He decided who should do and who should not do, even if you are the most talented person in the world. But these guys, they set up a platform, they allow you to write books and publish. Now actually editing is gone, I myself do editing if I'm a writer. And people who read books are the ones who really say, I'm good or bad, it's not the editor. So this actually, again, open up a totally different economy where, you know, I can publish books without going through the whole paradigmic use of book. So they can publish a book in 14 days. Whereas it took about maybe 1 year. So digital has done a lot of wonderful things and good things, right? Which we should embrace. Now, everybody spoke, I think this is a bit of business for you guys. Okay? BMW, everyone knows? Everyone rides or want to ride, right? So you will not say. So BMW set up in 1916, like centuries old organization. It has 116,000 employees. Their market capitalization is $53 billion. Whereas Uber, set up in 2009, 7,000 employees, $60 billion market capitalization. So what does this tell? A lot of things maybe in the past took centuries to get to where they are, but now I think it takes a few years. That's because, you know, your reach is quite fast. The use case is very appealing, and people do wonderful things. Similarly, Marriott. There's Marriott coming to Sri Lanka soon. 1987, 200,000 employees globally. Market cap is $17 billion. Whereas Airbnb does not have any room. They piggyback on someone else's hotel room. Set up in 2008, 5,000 employees, $21 billion. This list goes on. So something has changed significantly in the world because digital has come to play a role. And people who are smart thought about, you know, ideas never existed and turn things around, all of a sudden bingo, you know, you got something very interesting. So thanks to digital. So this was made possible by internet and smartphones. Nothing but that was the game change or the significant change that happened. So we put internet in everyone's pocket. It's part of our life. No one can function without a smartphone now, right? And me. App Store and Google Play change the way people develop software and deliver. And even how we work. Now, before I left office, actually my office is 500 meters away, next to Jack Hilton. I could easily walk, but I decided to drive. But I always have seen there's a traffic jam here. So the moment I got into the car, first thing I went to Google Apps, Google Maps, and checked that there's traffic jam after the red bar. Right? Then I knew that I hate to get late at home. I won't be on time all the time. So I know that I can make it. So I use to. Okay. So I think every day there is some use. Now, you know, Uber Eats is in Sri Lanka now. Have anyone tried Uber Eats? No? Okay, you should try. It's very good. Since I said that, I'll tell you a little story. So I have a guy called Balan in our office. He actually bring lunch for me. He thinks it's a privilege to bring lunch for me for some reason, which I don't think so, right? So one fine day, generally his routine is to come around 11 o'clock and ask, you want lunch? Then I say, yes, bring. Then he asks, what? I mean, I say, okay, he sends that over. so then he goes and looks. Now, if I'm not having lunch, then I say, no, I'm going out or something. So, quality in there. So now, few days ago when Uber Eats appeared in Sri Lanka, I thought I would order. So I went to the app and I ordered food. So it said, probably I ordered from Pang or something, or Sammy. It said, okay, it will arrive in 20 minutes, which I found, okay, great. Now someone is telling me, okay, it will take 20 minutes. Sometimes when Balan goes out, I don't know whether it will come in 30 minutes or 1 hour, right? Because sometimes Balan does the same thing, because the Mahathyas also in office. So depending on choice of those Mahathyas, he can go few places and come back. So I can be hungry also. But anyway, this was I found to be, someone said 20 to 30 minutes, right? Then it says, okay, your order is being ready now, and then someone says, okay, so and so picked it up. And I can see the bike guy is coming, you know, I can see the same Uber route, I can see it, which I found to be very interesting. So now that day Balan comes and says, lunch? I said, no, it's okay, Balan. Are you going out? I said, no. Now he's faster than Balan, you know, all of a sudden confused why Tilak is not saying anything about it. Then again, I said, no. I said, I'm getting lunch. He said, okay. So the Uber guy came and gave me the lunch and he wanted it. His ride and everything, which I did. And then now Balan found out there's a new way of doing it. Now, so Balan is actually heartbroken now because, you know, he's not going to use his services. I don't think job security, but he thinks there's a problem, right? And for me, you know, I have saved 1 hour of his time plus more. And so it changed my life. Okay. So every day I experiment something and I figure out, you know, what can we do better and, you know, make ourselves free to do something more of human nature. And apparently check out about 47 times a day, is that correct? Probably I do about 200 times if I know right. Right? So it's a change. Any Catholics here? No worries, it's okay. So when the Pope Benedict, when he was announced in 2005, this is actually a picture taken in Vatican. Yeah, you know, they celebrate. I mean, subdued, you know, people are having tax and things like that. In 2013, Pope Francis, everyone's taking selfies. Okay? So, the point is, we had a mobile phone, which I also had a camera. So, everyone, this is the behavior of people. I mean, not only that. Now, people go and publish it and say, hey, I was there. And then they come and, oh, you're so lucky to be there, you know, all this. And this whole thing goes on, like even so real. So at that time, to just say I was there after a few weeks, right? But now the thing is instantly. But it's a good thing. Now I gave you a major story about a lot of things that happened, right? But now we'll come down to what does it mean to banking in Sri Lanka and what we do. So we went through this whole journey of, you know, what customers need, what our staff can do, how to change things and, you know, do better things and things like that. So we decided to do a few things because we want to change the world and we want to change the financial services as well. Anyone heard about this? Yes? No? Are you all using? Okay. So we thought, because, you know, those days when you want to deal with money, you'll have to go to a bank branch. And the branch manager is a big person but significant personality in the society. So you were trying to look, I want to open an account, you know, he actually serious about it, you know, fill about 10 forms, all that. If you really look at, they are crap. Right? And there's no real value of it. So we thought, let's make it digital. So now you don't have to go to a branch, you just download the app, you sign up, and you are actually opening a savings account by doing this. Okay, I mean, that's all what you need to do your financial thing, that's good enough, right? Then I think somewhere, central bank wants us to at least make one business if you exist. There's some legal thing. So now we actually just call and say, can we come and see you? And, you know, you go and see you. Sometimes even take cakes for, you know. And so now, whole digital onboarding, digital banking has come. Not that other banks didn't have this, they all had, but they were more of having a digital app to their existing customers. So this is one step further, it's like a bit of Airbnb kind of thing, you went one step further and set up something which others didn't, but probably others will do as well. So far we have got about 110,000 downloads, which is quite big in a situation like Sri Lanka with 20 million population. Then also we came up something called open API banking. So if you, as management students, I strongly recommend you read about open banking API. It's a new economy which you can create. It's nothing but in simple terms, have you heard about ERPs, enterprise system, like SAP and things like that? So you know the every organization, take for example the big conglomerate like John Deere. So they have their own ERP, they do all resource planning in the organization with that system. But every system also needs a connection to their financial system, which is a bank. So for an example, John Deere won't make a payment to some contractor who renovated his own brand. So they first go and make that entry on the system. So I had to pay ABC contract 50 million rupees, they fix our ceilings. Okay. Now when you do that, it happens on their side, but you have not actually given the money, you have to tell the bank to do that now. So you go to the bank and again do the same thing on the internet banking system what you use. But through open API banking, you link the bank and the ERP together. When you do that on one system, it goes to the next system as well. So basically it becomes seamless. From a productivity point of view, which we are all interested in, you can cut down about 50% easily. Right? And the controls you have in the organization can be applied to banking as well. So this is a significant step forward from a banking point of view in Sri Lanka. So we were the first bank to do that, by the way. Even the other one was the first bank to do that. So we did a lot of first time things. But first time doesn't mean that you're going to get everything, but others also will do. Then like any other banks, we also have another app for existing customers. I mean, they can use this and that, premium, mobile banking, it doesn't matter. And so we have this as well on the digital space. So we also have a cash management solution. Cash management solution is now, if you don't want to open banking API, you can do this one. But you will do one thing on ERP, you will come to this and do the banking part as well. But here again, this is actually much better than coming to the bank with slips and say, okay, transfer 50 million rupees from your Keels account to ABC contract or whatever. So you can do from your own desk. So we have all these systems that we can call it ecosystem in place at the moment. Okay. This is a very important management lesson, by the way, not a technology learning. So, look at this carefully. I'm sure you all may have seen this, probably have paid attention and not paid. So, the telephone took 75 years to reach 50 million customers. And that's now quite expected because I said, my home phone took 13 years now. So, that's why it has certain well. But things became better and better with advancement technology and also advancement of our approach to problem resolution. So the radio took 38 years, television took 13, then internet came, it took 4 years. So after that, everything what happened was, I think had happened on top of internet, largely speaking. Facebook took 2 years, Instagram took 19 months, YouTube 10 months, Twitter 9 months, Android was 35 days, Pokemon 19 days. So, what does it tell you as a management lesson? Things are happening faster, and maybe human can't cope up. Because human actually process things one at a time, can't think. Now the technology can process many things at a time. So, this is a world you all are living in and going to work. So, this is a great example, rather learning for all of you. So, now if you're going to do something when you start working, you have to be mindful about it. If you are not mindful about what will happen is this. So this was said by founder of World Economic Forum. In the new world, he said it's not the big fish which eats the small fish. And it's the fast fish which eats the slow fish. And if you go back to Uber example, Uber and the Airbnb examples, that's what happened. Say BMW took 100 plus years to get to where they are. But Uber took only 5 years, 6 years. Because they are the fastest fish, right? So this also has a learning for all of you. Okay, to get all this right, you have to have a digital marketing holistic approach covering everything that is on digital. You know, you have search engine optimization, then identify your competitors, your customers, and objectives, and you have email marketing, mobile marketing, this whole thing has been placed. But this is again not a very prescriptive thing. Depending on who you are, where you are, what you want to do, you have to have a digital marketing strategy as well. Okay, so, and this is something that you are trying to do, I guess. Now, I was asked to talk about this responsive web versus native web, which is better. Which is better? Any thoughts, any ideas? No? Nothing is better, I guess. Okay. Answer this is this. It's a difference between responsive and native is nothing but it's like a car and a motorbike. Both can take you from A to B. However, I mean, there's nothing you can't say one is better than the other. You can't say it has this thumbprint, right? You can sign on to the system even if your case is good. Now there is something existing in this, so it can be better used. It can be better used if you go native, but if you go hybrid or responsive, it may not be the case. So we go back to what we said earlier. It depending on where you are in your journey of digitization in your organization, you can adapt subject to money availability as well. So that brings me to the end of my presentation of whatever I was supposed to talk about. So next few minutes or half hour, we can take Q&As. If you have any questions, if you want to clarify anything, I mean, for that matter, not only this, anything else, we can talk about it, if that works. It's question time now. Yeah. dominant, I can do this. But if I am right hand dominant, you can't do that. Now your design has to be changed to cater that. The point where I'm trying to make is, when you design an app, it's not just coding and putting app. You have to pay attention to those design elements. Say every screen matters. I mean, if you look at carefully, most very popular apps, you know, Facebook, Instagram, and things like that, they have paid a lot of attention to this human element of user. And also, this is a very small screen, right? And you should be able to put many things, but not too many things, for someone to feel good about it when you look at it. And also, there are other things like there are natural, but you are doing intuitively doing things. If you take an app, everyone can do this, right? And that's natural to a lot of humans. So if it's natural, why not use it? So when you design an app, maybe you can use it. Yeah. So things like that we have brought into this whole design before we build. So, you know, dreaming, you know, it has a sample like this. You know, it's more like, you know, speed, you know, running and things like that. So you brought a lot of things into it. Probably you don't know why you attracted it. So those are maybe the reasons why it's attracted and probably others didn't pay attention to it. So that's kind of the answer. Except there are a few other very internal things which I can't discuss necessarily. And so that may be the reason. Then you also employ a lot of other people who are ethical hackers. You pay them to hack us and see whether they can do that. So that's another way of doing that. Then also, you also have to write skills in the organization. So you have to hire top-of-the-range guys. It can be very expensive, but you can pay them and give them, right? And it's something changing every day, right? Tomorrow you find another virus, another something happening, right? So you have to keep going. So we do that as a practice. I mean, we have people doing that for a living, like you can hack every day. Not sure if you have heard, if you go to Microsoft website, they talk about how they protect their cloud environment. So they have two teams called Red Team and Blue Team, and they don't know each other. So one guy actually tried to attack the system, the other guy is trying to protect the system. And they are globally sitting in different places. They are doing this for a living. Very interesting that someone is attacking, someone is protecting in the same organization. So, you know, you do things like that to protect your environment, so that's one thing we do. The second thing is there are standards. Actually, for open bank API, there are no standards in Sri Lanka. But there are standards published in EU, in the European Union, they have published. They call it PSD, rule, stands for Payment Service Directive number 2. There was number 1, now they have replaced it 2. So with that, they have published specific specification, including how to share data and how to prevent privacy, and you know, no one can take your data unless you consent. And there are a number of recommendations that are directive. And also, there's thing called OAuth 2. So that's a kind of security mechanism which came with PSD2. So you follow the same thing when we develop open APIs. So that's how we have protected it. This side. No questions? I think I'm sure you've mastered everything now, right? I'm going to give you the slides for them, you know, for your next question, exam. This will be one question. You're all going to master this.
Yeah. Now, what about the digital money when it comes to the technology, evolvement of technology, and but digital money versus paper money? How is the system the same or different systems you need? And I'm asking this question because of the unofficial people can come into systems and make their own banks with
yeah.
digital money. How?
Okay, if your question is it going to happen, it's going to happen. It's going to happen during our lifetime. I mean, you were another 2-3 years, so maximum 5 years it will happen. I think technologically speaking, that is already available, like Bitcoin is available, right? So you people who don't do trading. But I think the headache is for regulators and governments how to control this. Because today, if you look at every country, they have a central bank. There is a Minister of Finance who has this monetary policy and stuff like that they control. So they lose control of that entirely if you go this route. So everyone is, it's like a good problem to have, but no one is taking a step forward and regulating it. But actually a few days ago I read, Singapore has already issued regulations at the moment in the parliament for they were coming with a new legislation. So with that, probably, you know, that may be the starting point. But I think it's not a technological delay or limitation. It's just that regulators have not got around with it. So probably when they learn, they probably will do that. But there are a lot of advantages of doing that because if you take Sri Lanka, not sure how many people know, there are 640 billion rupees in circulation for in a given quarter. Every 3 months, 640 billion. For an annum, it's 2.3 trillion rupees cash in circulation, a lot of money. So if you quantify that production of notes to distribution of notes and this whole circulation, I think it costs about 1 or 3% of GDP, which is a lot of money. So if you have digital currency, you don't need that. And also, everything will be in a formal system. Like even from the lowest paid person to the highest paid person, will transact to a system. Then, you know, even for governments, if you want to catch them for taxes, you know that, you know, their size of wealth and transaction. So it has a lot of other advantages as well. But disadvantage is, okay, since it's a IT system, if it gets the wrong hand, it can go wrong. But I think that is more of a 0.001 probability. But I think I would say the good part will overweigh the bad parts. There are two ways of looking at now. I have done an extremely most boring presentation in my life and I bought you the hell. Or they mastered everything or they got everything right.